Hello students, let us start our new session with the new topic circular current loop as a magnetic dipole. So that is under the topic torque on a current loop magnetic dipole. Now we are taking another part, that is a circular current loop as a magnetic dipole we have. Now we are taking in that case. So magnetic element we have in the form of current loop which carry the current in the circular condition. Earlier case we have taken rectangle loop, now we are taking a circular loop. So the magnetic field at large distances due to a current in a circular loop is a same behavior as electric field of an electric dipole. So here the magnetic field on the axis of a current loop with the radius r carrying a steady state current I. So magnitude of the field that we have already determined for the circular path, that the circular path of the magnetic field available, that is over the axis yz, and the center of the circle is available at the x, and the direction of the momentum over the x direction. So that is we have already studied in earlier topic. So based on that, directly over here we can take the magnitude of magnetic field, that is B equals to mu 0 I r square upon 2 x square plus r square raised to 3 by 2. Now its direction is along the axis and is given by the right hand rule. X is the distance over the x axis from the center of the loop. X is very much larger than the r. So we can drop the r square from the denominator of the above equation. So we can reduce that equation with B equals to mu 0 r square by 2 x cube. Now area A equals to pi r square. So here put the value A. So here r square is nothing but a by pi. So we can keep it over here. So that is mu 0 I a upon 2 pi x cube. From in the above equation I is missing. It would be mu 0 I r square upon 2 x cube. So now magnetic momentum m with the magnitude I a. So m equals to I a. So from the above equation we can replace I a with the m. So that is magnetic field B equals to mu 0 m upon 2 pi x cube. So mu 0 upon 2 pi, mu 0 upon 4 pi into 2 m upon x cube. We can rewrite in this form, in the standardized form. So this equation is very similar for the electric field of a dipole, that mu 0 can be like a 1 upon epsilon 0 in the electric field equation. Magnetic momentum M is like an electrostatic dipole momentum PE. Magnetic field B is like an electrostatic field E. So that equation we have E equals to 2 PE by 4 pi epsilon 0 x cube. So here the field of an electric dipole at a point on its axis is given by the above electrostatic field equation. From that we can provide the analogy. From the first chapter we can say that E equals to PE upon 4 pi epsilon 0 x cube for the bisector of the dipole. Bisector matlab we can divide it in the perpendicular form. So electric field on the perpendicular of the bisector of the dipole, so electric field is half of it. So that would be PE divided by 4 pi epsilon 0 x cube. X is the distance from the dipole. So in that equation, if we replace PE with the magnetic momentum M, mu 0 with the 1 upon epsilon 0, so above equation we can rewrite in terms of mu 0 upon 4 pi into M upon x cube. So this is same as the magnetic field equation for the half dipole. above equation for the circular loop, that is mu 0 upon 4 pi into 2m upon x cube. Now we have equation, that is b by 2. So that is mu 0 upon 4 pi m by x cube. The same equation we have over here. So here we can say the result of electric field and magnetic field are become exact for a point magnetic dipole. So the above obtained result, from that we can, that can we can, it can be sure to apply to any planar loop. A planar current loop is equivalent to a magnetic dipole of dipole momentum m equals to Ia, which is the analogy of electric dipole moment PE. Now the fundamental difference of the electric dipole is built up of charges through the monopoles, that is by charges. Now in magnetism, the magnetic dipole is based on the element, that is a current loop. So basically the magnetic dipole or the current loop we have, that is a single element. And in the magnetic field, this electrostatic potential is available due to the charges. So for the current loop, we can say that it produces a magnetic field and behaves like a magnetic dipole at a larger distance. While the distance is larger, continuous magnetic field strength is available. It can consider as a magnetic dipole. Second condition is, it is a subject to torque like a magnetic needle. This led Ampere to suggest that all magnetism is due to circulating currents. If the current is circulating, torque is observed. It seems to be partly true, and no magnetic monopoles have been seen so far. However, monopole for the magnetic field is not there, its element is there. Right? And torque is available when the circular current is flowing through it. So elementary particles such as an electron or proton also carry an intrinsic magnetic momentum, but not accounted by circulating current. And if circulating current is there, only the magnetic field can be produced and the torque can be available. Now the third part is the magnetic dipole moment of a revolving electron. Now we are seeing that at the center part, positive charge is there, and in the orbital path around it, electron is moving in a circular path. As the reference of the above point, a circular loop, circular dipole, and at the end we have observed that charge particles can carry a magnetic field but not in circular current. So here, to observe this condition, we are taking a Bohr model, in which at the center positive charge is available and it around electron is traveling just like a planet revolves around the sun. So the force is available is electrostatic field based on the Coulomb's law, just like a gravitational force is available between planet and sun. So as shown in the figure, electron has the negative charge, that is with the 1.6 into 10 to minus 19 coulomb. It is revolving in uniform circular motion around a heavy nucleus charge, that is denoted as a plus Ze. So it constitutes a current I, that is equal to E by T, that is a charge per time Q by T. Now charge is single electron E and time is taken to complete a one revolution, that is a T. So T is the time period of revolution and the radius is available of that orbital path R. So that T is 2 pi R V. V is the frequency. So that total current I we have replace the value of t, that is E into V upon 2 pi r. So there will be a magnetic momentum is available. By the value mu L. So magnetic momentum, it is denoted as a mu L. It is associated with a circulating current. So its magnitude mu L is that is I pi r square. Mu L equals to I pi r square. So here it is replace the value of I, so that is EV upon 2 pi r, pi pi would be cancel out, r at once would be cancel out. So resultant equation of mu L, magnetic momentum, is defined as EV r by 2. So now the direction of this moment, magnetic momentum, is into the plane of the paper, as shown in the figure. Now we are going to multiply and divide the right hand side of the above expression by the electron mass. So that equation we have, that is multiply and divide with ME, that is mass of the electron. So E ME VR upon 2 ME. So ME VR is replaced by the L. So my mu L equals to E into L upon 2 ME. So here L is the magnitude of the angular momentum of the electron about the central nucleus. So it's that is angular momentum. It is defined as mu L equals to minus E upon 2 ME L. Here it defines magnitude. Bold letter defines the magnitude. L is defined the angular momentum. So magnitude, that momentum is there. So vector quantity is available. While we focus it's a magnitude with the bold letter, the negative sign is defines. It shows that angular momentum of electron is in the opposite direction of magnetic moment. Magnetic field moment and the electron moment is in opposite direction. If we have a positive charge, then magnetic momentum and angular momentum of the charge both are in the same direction. So while we are taking the ratio of magnetic momentum with its L, angular momentum, so mu L by L is E upon 2 ME and its value is 18.8 × 10⁻¹⁰ coulomb per kilogram for a electron, for a single electron. So at an atomic level, there is a magnetic momentum confirmed through the Ampere's bold hypothesis of atomic magnetic moments. According to Ampere, that can help to explain the magnetic properties of the material. Now, can one assign a value to this atomic dipole moment? Yes, anyone can assign to do so using the Bohr model. Bohr hypothesized that angular momentum assumes a discrete set of values. So I equals to NH upon 2 pi. N is a natural number. H is the Max Planck constant, H 6.626 × 10⁻³ joule into second. This condition for discreteness is called the Bohr quantization condition. Discreteness is there, so quantization effect is available. Means that is a roundabout values are taken at a certain distance. Continuous charge moment we are not using, but up to the certain distance we are going to observe. So here we are going to calculate for the dipole moment. We are taking N equals to 0. So mu L, N is 0, the minimum value we are taking. So that defines as a mu L minimum. So that is E upon 4 pi m e h. Replace the value of E, 1.6 into 10 raised to minus 19. H is a Planck constant, 6.63 into 10 raised to minus 34. Divide by 4 into pi, 3.14 into mass of the electron, 9.11 into 10 raised to minus 31. So the value is given, 9.27 into 10 raised to minus 24 ampere into meter square. So that is, this value is called for Bohr magnetron. So here mu L, that L is defined the orbital momentum. First orbit L is 1, second orbit L is 2, likewise. So here the electron has an intrinsic magnetic moment which has the same numerical value as given in the equation, that called the spin magnetic moment. Within that orbital path, the magnetic moment is there. It's a spin magnetic moment. So we hasten to add that it is not as though the electron is spinning. Electron is not spinning the moment, as we are saying spin moment, but electron is not spinning over the orbital path. Electron is moving, not spinning. So electron is an elementary particle. It does not have an axis to spin around like a top or a earth. So it does possess this intrinsic magnetic moment. The microscopic roots of magnetism in iron and other material can be traced back to this intrinsic spin magnetic moment. If we are taking iron particles, then we can observe its spin moment. But electron does not have a spin moment, it's a slightly moving condition is available. Now, let us go through the another topic, the moving coil galvanometer. So here galvanometer consists a coil with a number of turns that free to rotate about a fixed axis in a uniform radial magnetic field. At both the sides, uniform magnetic field is given. Based on that, inside of that, spring is given with the coil. Scale is defined with the pointer. And with the permanent magnets are there. So here, cylindrical soft iron core, which is not only makes the field radial, but also increases the strength of the magnetic field. For that, we are using iron cylindrical core. Now, when a current flowing through the coil, a torque is present. So, torque is NIAB, N for the number of turns, as we observed earlier. So, that for the single turn, current I. So, IAB we have observed earlier. Multiply with the N, the number of turns. So here, if the field is radial by design, if we are taking sin theta equals to 1 in the above expression for the torque. So that torque is NIAB tends to rotate the coil. Now spring SP is provided at the center to provide a counter torque K phi, which balance the magnetic torque NIAB. So the resulting steady angular deflection phi is available. Based on the magnetic field, torque is available, that is NIAB. So spring provides the counter torque, that is the Ken phi. So we can say the deflection becomes steady. So compare the both the result. So K phi equal to NIAB, where K is the torsional constant of the spring. So phi equals to NAB by KI. So NAB by K is constant values. Now galvanometer can be used in the number of ways, as we have already used to check the, generally it can be used to measure the current flowing through the circuit, as we have already utilized in Wheatstone bridge in previous chapter. So in which at the diagonal point between B and D, we have connected a galvanometer to neutralize or to balance the bridge, we are observing that no current is flowing through the middle part, that is from the galvanometer. Now, depending on the direction, the pointer is deflect either right or left side. As we have observed in the figure, the pointer is there. So, galvanometer cannot be used as an ammeter to measure the value of the current for the following two reasons. First, galvanometer is a very sensitive device. It used a full-scale deflection for the current in order of microampere. So, more than a microampere current is there, galvanometer cannot be utilized. For measuring the currents, the galvanometer has to be connected in series, and as it has a larger resistance, this will change the value of the current in the circuit. So, generally, if the higher resistance connected in the series, the total current is going to be reduced. So, in this sensitive circuitry, galvanometer cannot be utilized. To overcome these difficulties, we are going to attach a smaller resistance value RS in parallel of the galvanometer. So, as we know, parallel combination, equivalent resistance of parallel is lesser than less value. Galvanometer resistance is very much high. In parallel, if we are keeping less resistance value, so equivalent value is lesser than less. So, the circuit equivalent resistance cannot be affected much. So, current flowing through the circuit cannot be reduced. So, in that case, parallel combination RG into RS upon RG plus RS. So, it is equivalent to RS because RG is very much high. So, here it can be negligible and small resistance value is observed. Now, as shown in the figure, ammeter, for that to calibrate the current, we are keeping RS in the parallel of the circuit. With the galvanometer, RG is shown, the internal resistance of the galvanometer. With that in the parallel, less value of RS we are going to be connected. So, here the current sensitivity is from the above equation, phi equals to NAB by K into I. So, phi by I equals to NAB by K, which is the constant value. So, here, for the convenience, to get the better sensitivity, number of turns can be increases. If N is higher, phi by I ratio is higher, sensitivity is higher. Now, to measure the voltage, we are connecting a larger resistance value in series of that galvanometer. Because to measure the voltage, voltmeter is connected in parallel of the circuitry. So, to draw a very small current, generally, we are increasing the resistance of the voltmeter. So, no current or very less current is passing through the voltmeter. For that, we are connecting large value of R in series of the galvanometer. So, equivalent resistance is RG plus R, which is very much high. So, now its sensitivity is phi by V equals to NAB by K, I by V. We have phi equals to NAB by K into I. Both the side V will be divided to get its sensitivity. So, phi by V equals to NAB by K, I by V. I by V is 1 by R. So, this is the sensitivity is available. Now, to increase its sensitivity, if we are increasing the number of turns from N to 2N, then for the current sensitivity, it increases phi by I to 2 phi by I. So, current sensitivity will be double. But if we increase the number of turns from N to 2N, so my R is also increases by 2R. If number of turns are increases, resistance is increases. So, it is not much affected for the voltage sensitivity. So, it remains phi by V to phi by V as it is. So, here, in general, the modification needed for conversion of galvanometer for the ammeter will be the different, and for the voltmeter, it is different. Now, let us observing the example. In the circuit, the current is to be measured. What is the value of the current if the emitter is shown? First case is a galvanometer with the resistance RG equal to 60 ohm. Second case, if the galvanometer is described in A but converted in the emitter by the shunt resistance RS is 0.02 ohm. In the third case, in an ideal emitter with zero resistance. First case in which RG is given 60 and third ohm resistance is already given in the circuit diagram. So total resistance is in the series RG plus 3, that is 63 ohm. So I equals to V by R. Battery potential is given 3 by total resistance 63. So current is 0.048 ampere. So as if with the galvanometer, RS low value of resistance is connected in shunt in parallel. So equivalent total resistance is RG into RS upon RG plus RS. Place the value of RG and RS, so it would be 0.02 ohm. Now that equivalent is come across in series with the given circuit resistance 3 ohm. So my total resistance become 3 into 3.02 ohm. So now my current is V by R. V is a 3 volt. Total resistance 3.02 ohm. So it would be 0.99 ampere. So how the resistance value in series or parallel affected to my current? For the ideal emitter, zero resistance of the galvanometer is there. So the circuit voltage 3 volt battery divided by circuit resistance 3 ohm, that would be 1 ampere. So this is how all these three components we have observed through the example. So here we are going to end our session as well. We are going to end our chapter. Hope you understood the whole chapter thoroughly. Thank you.